It's good to be here this morning. Thank you, Mr. Welcome, for covering last week. No, you covered on Friday for me. Billy Miller was here last week. All right, y'all survived him, so bless the Lord. No, thank you. Barely, somebody said. Okay, good. Billy's not here. So, anyway, glad to be here this morning. Hey, guys, we've been in John chapter number 40. You guys who are new, thank you for being here this morning. I hope you'll come back and invite other people to come. We've been in John chapter number 4 forever. In fact, we've been talking about love because it's the subject we can, you know, John talks about it. He goes in and out of this subject of love and the whole idea of abiding. Sometime in the book of 1 John, it's abiding. Sometime it's remain. Sometime it's dwell in the old King James, but it all means the same thing. It means to stay put, right? To dwell, to abide, to remain. It means to stay put. I think 18 different times that word meno is used, the Greek word. And so he's talking about fellowship, walking with the Lord. That's why God made you. God made you for fellowship. God made you that you might walk with him and enjoy fellowship with him. That's your purpose in life. Your purpose in life is to fellowship with God and give glory to him. Right? Your life, my life, our humanity is a stage where God can should be glorified on. That's a otherworldly concept, and we battle with it because we're so myopic, we're so nearsighted that we think that it's like little children who think right here and right now is all there is. They don't think about it. Little children don't plan. They don't have right now is what's important, and we by and large are just the same way. We live like this, like there ain't no such thing as eternity. We live for the right here and right now, so we go after this, go after that, go out because it gives this immediate gratification with no elongated view of what real life is. But my life, your life, our lives is to glorify God, fellowship with him. That's the purpose. You're living out your purpose when you're walking with God. That doesn't put you in jeopardy, by the way. That puts you in that perfect place of purpose. Now, your ideas for success are in jeopardy, but that's what the Lordship of Christ means. You jettison your ideas of what success is, and you see what his ideas are, and you see that they're so much better than yours. But that's counterintuitive. We don't think that way. That's why God has given us the truth that makes us free, to comb the kinks out of our head, cause us to think as we ought to think, reorient us in this crazy world that says get what you can what you get, sit on the can, don't get mad, get even. All these things that the world says, and Jesus comes and simply takes the ladder of success and turns it upside down. And so he says success is racing for the bottom, right? Not the top. In fact, the stuff that's on the bottom is now on the top. The stuff that the world doesn't care about, doesn't want. You know, Jesus came and said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are they that mourn. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed, he just took the order and turned it upside down, because our ideas, assertiveness, aggressiveness, go for it, be number one, push to the top. So you just have to learn that. The book of John is about fellowship. It's walking with God. And walking is, again, this progressive thing. It's pedestrian, where you are step by step and it's day by day. There ain't no shortcut. Where you're learning how to be surrendered to God's will for your life, which is best, better than anything you can come up with. And to whatever degree we learn that and surrender to that and yield to that and walk with Him, acquiesce to Him in fellowship, to that degree we begin to really live. To that degree we begin to really enter into the kingdom. This is not just about in the sky by and by when you die. This is about walking with God right now. You have eternal life walking with God, and to whatever degree I agree with Him and walk with Him in fellowship, to that degree I'm entering into life. Eternal life is quality life. It's not just more time. It's the quality of life that you're living. Zoe life. Now, it's more than breathe in, breathe out, draw your paycheck, draw your next breath. It's about, you know, like the fullness of life, the realness of life. That's what eternal life, we think eternal life is something we're walking to. No, it's what you have when you receive Christ, because He is that life. The Christ life that you live, to whatever degree you yield to Him, to that degree you are walking in life. So here the book of John, this first John, is talking about this. And so He has been saying throughout the book, right? If you don't know the Lord, you don't know life, because He is that life. Now the world says, and Jesus tells a parable about this, the world says that you know, the bulging pockets and a nicely supplied home and a driveway with an impressive car, that's living. Right? That's living. And Jesus says that's not living. Jesus said in Luke 12 that a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. Things and stuff. But that's what we live in this world. That's what things and stuff and places, like we don't see ourselves as human beings, we see ourselves as human havings. I have, therefore I am. I do, therefore I am. I go, therefore I am. But life ain't where you go and what you do and what you have. It's what you are. Right? So it's blessed are. Not blessed has or blessed does. Blessed are. And so here in the book, he's saying, hey, to know the Lord is to know life, because He is that life. In Him was life. He is that life. He is that eternal life. And when Jesus doesn't just give life, He is that life. When we have Him, we have life. Right? So I might say, no Lord, no life. Okay? He says in this book, same book, no light, no life. You know, because that Lord is light. He says in John chapter number 1, in Him was He is the light of the world. In fact, Jesus said He's the light of the world. But let me read this passage. He says over in 1 John chapter number 1, in verse number 6. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and we walk in darkness, we lie. We don't tell the truth. You're not walking. If you say you're walking with God and you're walking in darkness, that's a lie. That's a challenge to me. That's a challenge to me for August the 23rd, 2022. Now that's a challenge. If today I say I'm walking with God and I'm walking in darkness. Darkness is a word, not a cold word, but a word that means, bespeaks evil, that which is unrighteous, that which is untoward. If I say that I'm walking with the Lord and I'm walking in darkness, there is no light, I am a liar. I'm lying today. That's a challenge to me, okay? If we walk in the light, or, you know, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. So to no Lord, no life, no light, no life. If you're walking in darkness, you're not walking with the Lord. But what we've been occupied with over the last few weeks, couple of months, is the concept of no love, no life. You don't have love, you don't have life. Why? Because God is love. Right? So he's just cutting through this stuff. All these notions we have in our minds about maybe what we think Christianity is. And so much of it is have to do with we think in our minds behavior. But it's about the life of God. And when you have that life, he says, it's evident because you walk in love. And now love, just like anything else that you walk in, is progressive. We learn how to walk in love. I don't presume to tell you that I'm walking perfectly in love, but if I'm walking in love, I am maturing in love. That's why the Bible talks about our love being perfected. That word is not being made pristine, perfect. The idea is it's maturing love. You walk with the Lord, you walk in love. Incongruent to say that I'm walking with the Lord, I'm saved, and I don't walk in love. That's the whole point. If you're talking about fellowship, walking with God, he said you walk in light, you walk in life, you walk in love. Because God is all these things. He's life, he's Lord, he's love. He says here, so over here, he calls us beloved. Why does he call us beloved? By the way, let me just say this. Some of us are newer in here. Please understand this. When we talk about, when I was saying just a minute ago that so much of what we think about in Christianity is like behavioral. I don't do this, I don't do this, I do this, I do this. Kind of like Christianity is about life. It's about the life of God in me being lived out. Jesus didn't come to be a self-help guru, right? To teach you how to do life on your own. He came to be our life, right? And he doesn't give us a list of things to do. The last thing on this earth I need is another list of things to do. Amen. Right? He doesn't want me to, listen, he doesn't want me to master anything. He wants me to be mastered. Amen. Right? He wants to master me. I'm not telling you there are no disciplines in life and things you want to practice and train yourself in righteousness. The Bible talks about that. But the Christian life is not about mastering a list of things. Check, 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 check. Right? Like I've used illustration. This guitar over here doesn't have to know the song. It just have to be mastered by the one who knows the song. Piano doesn't have to know the song. You just have to be available for the one who does know the song. And we spend our time. It's about the life of the Lord. It's like if I'm walking with Jesus, Lord Jesus, by your Spirit, love people through me. Help me not to get in your way of loving people. Help me to be a surrendered person, right? So lay down all my prejudices and my preferences and all these things, so that when Joe Blow from Idaho comes in the room, all of my filters and stuff like that I've got so ensconced in me. Mom and them taught me, dad and them, how I came up, my culture, where I've got 10 reasons not to love him and he hadn't even opened his mouth. You know how we act, right? I don't love him because he's wearing a t-shirt. I don't subscribe to what he advertising. I don't love him, he's wearing a Donald Trump hat, or I don't love him, he's wearing a Joe Biden hat. I don't love him, he's got a rainbow flag on. Y'all know what I'm talking about. What Tim t-shirt said? I thought that was a billboard. That's what I said. Dude, don't. Do that. Yeah, no, I just thought. Dude, don't touch my guitar. Okay. But you know, like, I've got these things built into me. Bing! You know. And I'm not talking about sloppy agape. I'm talking about walking with the Lord and choosing to love people because God loved people. God's in the people business. And the person I am probably this quick to be judgmental over needs the same grace that saved me. It's just need, you know what I'm saying? The person I have contempt for needs compassion. Now, he may not let me give it to him because he hates my guts. The Bible says the world going to hate you, and people, when men are lovers of their own selves, they're not going to love other people. And so people are all messed up in the head. But as a believer in Christ, as somebody walking with the Lord, I understand that. So I don't want to hate the racist because the racist hate me. You follow what I'm saying?
Yes.
I don't want to. So he's saying here, beloved, this is, we're back to verse number 11, chapter number 4, right? We can't seem to get past this. If God so loved us, that kind of like nevertheless love for Kenny Grant, the nevertheless who saw me in my sin before I ever been saved, and my junk since I've been saved. And he's got this stubborn nevertheless love for me. If God so loved us, right? This is an argument he's making. Doesn't this make sense? If God so loved us, we ought also to what? Love one another. Right? When we get to thinking about love, let's think about the love God has for us. When God has for me, the love that God has displayed and shown to me. This is how you have to always think about this thing in context of the truth of the Word of God. If not, you will outgrow your hat. You walk around as a spiritual snob. You know, I got saved yesterday, and I look at all those sinners. Right? So people need the Lord. People need. So I'm to be the light of the Lord. I'm to be a light. I'm to be salt. I am salt. I am light. When I live in love, when I live in His commandments, when I obey Him, I am showing forth His glory. So when I love and learn to love and learn to walk in love, surrender to love, allow Jesus to love people in me, right? I'm obeying Him. So He says this, no man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us, and His love is perfected in us. What does that mean? His love is perfected in us. I believe that us there is an us that talks about us corporately. So nobody has seen God. What do we say? Nobody has seen God, but when He sees a group of people, believers, loving one another and loving others, the love of God, right, is shown in its fullness. It's shown in its fullness. That's how it, you know, a community of love, even the world takes notice of that. I don't lay every problem in the world at the foot of the church. I don't say, well, the reason we got this problem because some people make a living talk about what's wrong with the church, right? And I can be, you know, the problem with Christianity is Christians, right? So I know that. I'm one. But I don't lay every problem in the world at the foot of church. But here's what I do believe. I believe God has a formula for us to reach the world and make a difference. And it ain't what we see in the political season with Christians mean-spirited and judgmental. And it ain't that. It ain't Christians rolling up our sleeves and taking matters into our own hand because, like, we've chucked Christianity. This love and salt and influence and being what God's called us to be, that doesn't work. We got to go to Washington. When God's way is for us to simply obey Him, we may get in trouble for it. We may be persecuted, right? But blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. We may look like sheep for the slaughter. We may look like losers. Because the world don't run to get in that line. Meek and merciful, and the world don't want to get in that line. So you may look like a bunch of chumps, but when you love one another, folk can't deny you love one another, and you love them. That God's got a plan for the evangelism of the world, and it's for Christians, for us to be Christians. And I'm telling you, I'm one of the ones who want to carry a sign and who wants to, you know, like, they ain't right. That don't make us, that don't, you know, they're wrong, don't make us right. I'm one of those ones. But you know what? God's got a better way. That's what He calls love. The more excellent way, anyway. So, hereby know we that we dwell in Him and He in us. Here's how. Because He's given to us His Spirit. By the way, you know, God in me gives me the capacity and the desire to love. It's God in me. It is His Spirit, right? Where the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by who? The Holy Spirit. The life of God in me. Like the DNA of Christians. It's the obedience of love. And don't give me nothing else. And I don't, we're not interested in how smart you are and how much Bible you know. I know people who will argue all day about the doctrines of grace and the validity of the gifts and what's argue all day long about that, because that's the measure of our Christianity. Do you agree with me on these things? And that's how we measure whether or not this brother is a good brother. They believe all these things, right? And so we kid ourselves into thinking that's what Christianity is. That's the Western thought in Christianity, measuring one another by these things and ignoring this simple thing of loving one another. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him. And he in God. John says, and we have known and come to believe the love that God hath to us. Let me ask you that. Is that a reality in your life? Have you come to believe the love that God has toward us? I mean, has that happened? Right? Because I believe this is what changes our lives, even as Christians. I believe the love of God. We have so many lesser loves. We love so many other things. We don't behold the one who loved us. I believe it's in beholding the manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that changes our lives. The really what Paul called the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Right, his love for me and reciprocally my love for him, that Paul says that love that constrained him, it urged him on. Was that his love for Christ? Yes, but his love for Christ was only reciprocating God's love for him. So have you come to believe that? You see how much God loves you, because this love is what really, this thing is what really will change us. What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we, the likes of you and me, should be called the sons of God, the children of God, the people of God. And that will grab you, the extent of that, I think, will grab you when we really have thought about where we were and where he saved us from. You know what will really, I think, move us away from ho-hum Christianity? Just dwelling on these things. You know what I call ho-hum Christianity? It's what Jesus said about the church at Laodicea. The church at Laodicea is lukewarm, room temperature, tepid, ho-hum. What rescues us from ho-hum? I'm a Christian. You know what really is like the love of God, beholding the love of God. Well, herein is love made perfect, our love made perfect, complete. That we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the world. What does John mean by that? okay? I think, and I've read different commentaries, and I think John is saying here that love, just like I believe love is the greatest apologetic in the world, right? Not, what do you mean by the greatest apologetic? I mean, I can give you Bible answers. I can be the Bible answer man and answer all your questions. But really the greatest apologetic, the greatest thing that argues for Jesus Christ is the love Christians have for one another and for others. It's almost can't be argued against. Sort of a, this otherworldly love, this supernatural love that's shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit of God. I believe just like that, that love is the greatest assurance that you're saved. And gives you confidence for the day of judgment. Me just loving people as I'm supposed to love people. This is the greatest assurance that I have. The commandment of love, obeying the commandment of love, loving people, gives me confidence for that day. There is no fear in love, verse 18. But perfect love casts out fear. You know, I don't have perfect love here. I don't have a complete and perfect love. But you know, the Bible says that I am to be walking in love. The Bible says walking in love. I read this passage. Let me go back over here to the to what Jesus said over in Matthew chapter number 5. Let's go over there again quickly. We looked at how love looks, how love, perfect love, behaves. We see that in 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. He gives us what this most excellent way looks like, what this perfect love looks like. But here's what Jesus says over here. Verse number 43 of Matthew 5. You have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, and by the way, Jesus was not given some progressive revelation. This is what it's always been. This is not new. God has always told people to love the stranger. God's a God of love. But the Pharisees had so convoluted the law, and these teachers, rabbis were teaching, love your enemies. I mean, love God, hate your enemies. Jesus came really to reinstate what God had always meant. The content and the intent of the law. And he says, I say unto you, love your enemies. Okay? Love your enemies. Then he says this. Now he begins to explain some of the ways that looks. Bless them that curse you. You ever did that? Yeah. I didn't say bless them out. I said bless them. You ever blessed somebody who cursed you? But he's showing us, he's unpacking what love your enemies look like. He says love your enemies, and then he unpacks it. This is some practical ways of how it looks. That person who would curse you, you bless them, you speak well of them. That's what the word bless mean here. Do good to them that hate you. Ever done that? This is otherworldly stuff now. And pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you The word persecute means harass you. Now listen to what how he puts it. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. In other words, like father, like son. He's not saying these things makes us God's children, but as God's children, we'll be like our Father. Because that's exactly the kind of love that God had for me when he was, when I was using his name in vain, when I was living my own life, when I was militating against him for control of my life. He had a stubborn, anyhow kind of love, a sovereign love that just, when I persecuted him, he loved me. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, that you may be acting like God's children, that you may behave like the children of God, like you're living out your family DNA, you know, in love. And then he says this about God. This is how, this is what God's love looked like. He makes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sendeth rain on the just and the unjust. Now, if you look at rain as being bad or good, or sunshine being bad or good, God is the God who is good to everybody. For if ye love them who love you, what reward have ye? In other words, big deal is what he's saying. Big deal. Do not even the publicans, the same, the publicans, the tax collectors, were in the mind of the Jewish person listening to this, the lowest, most despicable scumbag on the earth. He's a Jewish man working for the Roman government, a thief, and in the mind, when Jesus said the publicans do that, the publicans simply love the ones that love them. And if you salute your brother, if you only welcome people who welcome you, what do you more than others? Do not even the tax collectors so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. In other words, don't be inconsistent. Be consistently loving. Now, I don't have this non-flinching, always consistent love, but I'm seeking, I would pray, to walk in that love. And again, to mature in love, to grow. To walk is to progress, to walk in balance, to walk with some effort involved, to progress. And so, turn to Romans chapter, remember quickly, turn to, I'm closing here, turn to Romans 12, yeah, Romans 12. Thank he. So here's how love looks in, among us here. Verse number 9. Let love be without insincerity is what that means. Hate which is that which is evil. Right? Hate it. Now God doesn't tell me to hate the evildoer, but hate that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Hold on to that which is good. It's just like a basic tenet of love. Good men love good things. Despises the evil. Be kindly affectionate. devoted to one another with brotherly love, and outdo, listen, in honor, preferring one another, is how the King James reads it. But the idea is outdo one another in this. You wanna play keeping up with the Joneses? Hey, you wanna see who's outdo one another in showing honor to one another. That's how love looks. Look at verse number 12. Rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of saints, giving to hospitality, bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not, right? Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. This is how love looks. This is how that kindly affection, love looks. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceit. Recompense, or don't repay any man evil for evil, providing things honest in the sight of God. And if it be at all possible, as much as it depends on you, as much as God has given you the ability, live peaceably with all men. Like, don't walk around picking fights with people. You're doing that wrong. Don't walk around picking fights with people. Dearly beloved, don't take vengeance, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. In other words, leave that to the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. And in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. You say, yeah, that's where I'll get him. Okay, I'll get him. I'll eat his heart out. I'll heap. I don't believe God says burn. God wants us to scorch anybody. But I do believe that will melt a cold heart. Lord. Amen. I heap coals of fire upon his head. Not to scorch him, it's to melt him. You know, how you can destroy an enemy? Befriend him. And you've destroyed an enemy. You've made a friend. You destroyed an enemy. But anyway, I just think it interesting. God has told us, he's unpacked how love looks. This is love with work clothes on, you know. This is how it looks. Okay, I'm done. Let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you so much for thank you so much, God, that you have not left us to grope in darkness about what it means to walk in fellowship with you. You've not left us to grope in darkness about what it means to walk in love. You have unpacked it for us. You show it to us in your word. And God, to the sinful nature of man, this is really distasteful. But God, that work of the Holy Spirit, that work of the Holy Spirit of God teaches us to love. Help us to be obedient students. Help us to walk in love. Be glorified now in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We come together. We hear your word. We feel your presence. Our hearts are stirred. We are one body in Christ the Lord. Work through our fellowship. Let your voice be heard. We're a band of brothers, just imperfect men, a broken host of sinners, made whole again. Praise you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We're a band of brothers. lead us in this